Good evening. It's good to see everybody here this evening. Hope you've had a good, blessed afternoon. Ancient Middle Eastern shepherds lived in a pasture with the flock and were so much a part of the land as the sheep were. And through a lifetime of shared experience, shepherds nurtured enduring trust relationships with their sheep. When a lamb was born into the wilderness world, the shepherd took the trembling newborn into his hands, warming it and caressing it. And among the first sensations felt by the shivering lamb was the tender hands of the shepherd. The gentle voice of the shepherd was one of the first sounds to awaken the lamb's delicate eardrums. The shepherd lived with the lambs for their entire lives, protecting them, caressing them, feeding and watering them, and leading them to the freshest pools and the most luxuriant pastures, day and night, year in and year out. By the time the lamb grew to maturity, it naturally associated the touch of the shepherd's hands and the sound of the shepherd's voice with green pastures and still waters, with safety, security, love, and trust. Each sheep came to rely on the shepherd and to know his voice and his alone. They followed him and no one else. Of course, the lambs understood clearly who was in charge. Occasionally, the shepherd might tap an unruly lamb on the ear with a shepherd's crook, but this was a love tap embraced in an enfolding circle of relationship. And when the day's grazing was done and night was approaching, the shepherd would gather the sheep together and lead them into a protective fold. Some were crude makeshift circles of brush, stick and rocks, forming barricades four or five feet high, safe little fortresses in the wilderness. Others were limestone caves in the hillsides. Even today in Palestine, one can see roughly constructed temporary sheepfolds dotting the pastoral landscape. But each circle is incomplete, broken at one place to form an opening into the fold. Beside this portal, the shepherd would take his place as he gathered his flock into the fold for the night, and at times physically becoming the gate or door. Part of the nighttime ritual was the gentle inspection of each individual lamb. And one by one, each lamb would come under the shepherd's rod for review. Each would feel the shepherd's hands and hear his voice speaking its name. Under the care of the shepherd, the sheep would come in and go out and find pasture. With the whole flock examined and bedded down, finally, the shepherd himself would lie down, stretching his body across the opening. So the shepherd literally, physically, became the door. His body kept the door in and the dangers of the night out. No sheep could wander into danger because the shepherd's body held them in. Wolves and robbers could enter to harm the flock only over the dead body of the shepherd. Some claim that even in modern times, mourning will occasionally find scattered sheep without a shepherd. Upon investigation, a bleeding, battle-worn shepherd would often be found somewhere nearby, sometimes even a dead one. The shepherd would literally lay down his life for the sheep. The Apostle John records for us a discourse by Jesus concerning the flock of God in John chapter 10, verses 1 through 18. In this discourse, Jesus refers to himself as the door of the sheep and the good shepherd. This discourse was Jesus' reply to the conduct of the Pharisees who were stirring up confusion among the disciples. These men, claiming to be infallible guides of the ignorant, to be veritable shepherds of the flock of God, had ignored the advent of the true and good shepherd, had opposed the divine call and supreme claim of the Messiah, had set themselves to disturb and dislocate the relation between him and those who saw his glory. They had said, "We see," thus shown themselves to be willfully in the wrong. The fold of God's sheep was something different from their own expectations and definitions. Their way into it proved that they did not know its true nature. In the first paragraph, verses 1 through 6 of John chapter 10, Jesus gives a picture of flock and fold, door and doorkeeper, thief and shepherd. In the second paragraph, verses 7 through 10, he emphasizes the relationship between the door and the fold, claiming to be the door. And in the third paragraph, verses 11 through 18, he illustrates the function and the responsibility of the shepherd and the relation of the shepherd to the flock, and he claims to be the good shepherd. So if you will turn with me to John chapter 10, we will look at the first paragraph, verses 1 through 6, looking at the shepherd of the sheep. "Truly, truly, I say to you, the one who does not enter by the door into the fold of the sheep, but climbs up some other way, he is a thief and a robber. But the one who enters by the door is a shepherd of the sheep. To him the doorkeeper opens, and the sheep listen to his voice, and he calls his own sheep by name and leads them out. When he puts all his own sheep outside, he goes ahead of them, and the sheep follow him because they know his voice. However, a stranger they simply will not follow, but will flee from him because they do not know the voice of strangers." Jesus told them this figure of speech, but they did not understand what the things which he was saying to them meant. The shepherd's entrance into the fold must be the correct way. The fold apparently was a walled enclosure with a gate, as we've explained earlier. The walls were high enough to keep the sheep safely inside and to deter, although not completely prevent, the entry of a thief or a robber. The normal entry into the fold was by the door, but the thief and the robber would choose to enter in another way, by climbing over the wall or some other way. The Old Testament had viewed Israel as the sheep of God and God as the shepherd of Israel. We read in Psalm 23, verse 1, "The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want." And then we read in Psalm 80, verse 1, "Oh, give ear, shepherd of Israel, thou who dost lead Joseph like a flock." And then we read in the 100th Psalm, verse 3, "Know that the Lord himself is God. It is he who has made us, and not we ourselves. We are his people and the sheep of his pasture." And then the prophet Isaiah, chapter 40, verse 11, writes, "Like a shepherd, he will tend his flock. In his arms, he will gather the lambs and carry them in his bosom. He will gently lead the nursing ewes." The Old Testament also utilized the figure of false shepherds to represent those who were leading Israel astray and did not care for the people. For instance, we read in Ezekiel chapter 14, verses 2 and 3, "Son of man, prophesy against the shepherds of Israel. prophesy and say to those shepherds, thus says the Lord God, woe, shepherds of Israel, who have been feeding yourselves, should not the shepherds feed the flock? You eat the fat and clothe yourselves with the wool. You slaughter the fat sheep without feeding the flock. And then we read in Zechariah chapter 11, beginning with verse 17, woe to the worthless shepherd who leaves the flock. A sword will be on his arm and on his right eye. His arm will be totally withered and his right eye will be blind. That's not a pretty picture, is it? Characteristics that determine who is the shepherd and who is not are these. The true shepherd enters by the door rather than climbing the wall. Secondly, the doorkeeper knows him and lets him in. And thirdly, the sheep know him. They recognize his voice and he calls them by their names. He makes a distinction from any other sheep that may be kept inside the same fold. Now, how they do that, I really don't know, but they do. He knows them individually. And fourthly, they are his own because they belong to him, because they trust him. And hearing his voice, they follow him as he leads them out of the fold. Simply put, they are his sheep and no one else's. This is indicated by the way the sheep themselves respond to him. The scribes and the Pharisees did not understand what Jesus was saying. Sometimes we refuse to understand because we simply do not want to. You ever find that yourself doing that? No, I just don't want to do that. I'm not interested. I get accused of that when I'm watching a football game, baseball game, or even golf. If I'm watching something and Janet tells me, I don't find out till 2 weeks later she told me, right? Because I just don't want to, right? I'm not the only one guilty, right? But sometimes we think we can get by with remaining ignorant of certain issues. If I refuse to understand them, I will not have much expected from me. I don't know it, therefore, I cannot do it. Now, let's look at the second paragraph, the right door. So Jesus said to them again, truly, truly, I say to you, I am the door of the sheep. All those who came before me are thieves and robbers, but the sheep did not listen to them. I am the door. If anyone enters through me, he will be saved and will go in and out and find pasture. The thief comes only to steal and kill and destroy. I came so that they would have life and have it abundantly. Jesus refers to himself as the door of the sheep and not the door of the fold, as in verse 1. He is the door, not of the fold, so much as of the sheep in their individual capacity. As the door, Jesus claimed to be the way for the sheep to come in and have protection and care. For the sheep to have the safety, protection, and rest that the fold would provide, they must come to him. Jesus tells us in Matthew 11, verses 28 through 30, a passage we're all familiar with, and perhaps we can all quote, come to me, all who are weary and heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart, and you shall find rest for your souls, for my yoke is easy and my load is light. Jesus said to Thomas, I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes through the Father, but through me. John 14, verse 6. It is through Jesus Christ that we have access to the Father, as Paul tells us in Ephesians 2, verse 18. For through him we both have our access in one spirit to the Father. Jesus Christ, and this goes along with every claim made by him and made in his name. Peter made that proclamation while being in prison. They were told to no longer preach in his name. And Jesus made this statement, and it's really a profound statement. And it's the one that the world really needs to recognize and to understand that it is so true indeed. There is salvation in no one else. For there is no other name under heaven that has been given among men by which we must be saved. Can you imagine Peter saying that with enthusiasm? There is no one else. No one else can save us. Jesus Christ has always been the one way by which men have drawn near to the Father. The scribes and Pharisees were closing the door and plundering those whom they kept out of the kingdom of God. They were the thieves and the robbers. They came to steal, kill, and destroy. Those who go about teaching that one's eternal salvation comes any other way is like the thieves and robbers of which Christ makes reference to in this passage. If their teaching takes you away rather than closer to God, then they are robbing your soul of a place in eternal glory. We cannot let that happen. Why Jesus came? Jesus came that they might have life in contrast to death. And just have life, but that they might not just have life, but that they might have it abundantly. Life is that which is offered or given to those who truly believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of the living God, and might have life in his name. John 20, verse 31. John writes, what was from the beginning, what we have heard, what we have seen with our eyes, what we have beheld with our hands, concerning the word of life, and the life was manifested, and we have seen and bear witness and proclaim to you the eternal life which was with the Father and was manifested to us. 1 John 1, verses 1 and 2. And this is the promise which he himself made to us, eternal life. 1 John 2, verse 25. And this is the witness, and the witness is this, that God has given us eternal life. And this life is in his Son. He who has the Son has the life. He who does not have the Son of God does not have the life. 1 John 5, 11 and 12. And then looking at the last paragraph in John chapter 10. I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd lays down his life for the sheep. He who is a hired hand, not a shepherd, who is not the owner of the sheep, sees the wolf coming and leaves the sheep and flees. And the wolf snatches them and scatters the flock. He flees because he is a hired hand that does not care about the sheep. I am the good shepherd, and I know my own, and my own know me, just as the Father knows me, and I know the Father. And I lay down my life for the sheep. And I have other sheep that are not of this fold. I must bring them also, and they will listen to my voice, and they will become one flock with one shepherd. For this reason, The Father loves me because I lay down my life so that I may take it back. No one has taken away from me, but I lay it down on my own. I have authority to lay it down, and I have authority to take it back. This commandment I received from my Father. There's a contrast here, if you notice, between the hireling and the good shepherd. One lays down his life for the sheep. The other runs from anything that threatens to do harm to them, not the sheep, to them individually. And this is Jesus' way of teaching all those who will listen that he is the one who will lay down his life for them so they can enter into the kingdom of God. He is the only way. All the others are just pulling your leg. They're not the real thing. Even in our times, we are hearing about the great religious leaders of our day. And yet not one of them is known for willingly laying down his or her life for the sake of their disciples. Not even one. The hireling represents the false teachers of Jesus' day. Perhaps another way of saying it is that they are nothing more than just a substitute shepherd. They are not the owner of the sheep, and Jesus acknowledges that. You know, I don't know if there's anybody in this congregation that has a business by having rental houses, right? Anybody have rental houses? Don't raise your hand, but if you do, you can relate, okay? You know, it's a problem for those who own them and choose to rent them out because those living in them feel no obligation in keeping it up because it's not theirs. We always take better care of something if it actually belongs to us, don't we? They do not care for the sheep. Their concern is only for themselves. Christ's only concern is our welfare, not his. They run at the sign of danger. Jesus knew it was coming and faced it head on. The good shepherd, Jesus says, it's him. He knows his own. He knows God. He's willing to die for the sheep. You see, his death was voluntary. Greater love has no one than this, he tells them, that one lay down his life for his friends. You are my friends if you do what I command you. John 15, verses 13 and 14. We know love by this, that he laid down his life for us. And we ought to lay down our lives for the brethren. 1 John 3, verse 16. Isn't that rather ironic? Did that sounds a lot like John 3, 16? For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son. It is the full knowledge of his own sheep that Jesus lays down his life for the sheep. Those sheep are his followers in Israel. And then he makes reference to the other fold. He's making reference to his sacrifice for his sheep. And that includes all of us. And this is us. This is the Gentiles of the day in which he was speaking. The Jews did not want to hear this. He says they too will hear his voice. He says they will be brought together to become one flock not more than one. This is God's plan, not man's. Unity between the Jews and the Gentiles was not an option man came up with. It was and always has been God's plan. We see this taking place in the conversion of Cornelius and his household in Acts chapter 10. We see this taking place in the baptism of the Ethiopian eunuch in Acts chapter 8. We see it again with Lydia's baptism in Acts chapter 16, along with the Philippian jailer and his household. Paul tells us in Romans 1, verse 16, "For I am not ashamed of the gospel, for it is the power of God for salvation to everyone who believes, to the Jew first, and also to the Greek. For you are all sons of God through faith in Christ Jesus. For all of you who were baptized in Christ have clothed yourself with Christ. There is neither Jew nor Greek. There is neither slave nor free man. There is neither male nor female, for you are all one in Christ Jesus." Galatians 3, 26 through 28. Jesus was telling them, as he is telling us, that there is one flock with one shepherd, the one who willingly gave his life for his sheep, that they might have life themselves. He is loved by the Father. He is willing to die sacrificially. Matthew 26, verses 36 through 46, is the scene at the Garden of Gethsemane. To emphasize the voluntary giving of his life for men, he states, "I have the authority both to lay it down and take it up again." In doing this, Jesus was carrying out the charge or commandment he received from his Father. He was fully conscious that at the end of his ministry was the cross, as Paul tells us in Philippians 2, verses 6 and 7. "And just as he had spoken of his coming death before, so here he described a striking characteristic of the good shepherd as one who dies on behalf of his sheep." In verses 19 through 21 of John chapter 10, we read that these words spoken by Christ cause a division among the people. From here on, we see that there is a distinct difference between those who believe in him and those who refuse to believe in him. And this is when the plot to have him killed really thickens. What about us? Are there any doubters? How can one question Christ's love and concern for his sheep when knowing of his willingness to die for them? What about us? Is he our good shepherd? Or do we just kind of take it at something that's being said and just kind of let it pass? Oh, he may be a shepherd, but he may be like the others. No, he's not like the others. He will stay in the doorway, even if it means that he will die. And you know what? That's what he did. So how can we question whether or not Christ loves us? How can we question what he has done for us as being a great gift? We who are sinners, we who are like the sheep, are like sheep gone astray without a shepherd. Now we know that we have a shepherd, that we can truly follow and know good and well that he will protect and care for us and cleanse us of our wrongdoing. If there is anyone who has not yet responded to Jesus as being the Son of God and has not repented of their sins and put Christ on a baptism, we strongly encourage you to come now as together we stand and we sing.